वक्रतुण्डमहाकाय सूर्यकोटिसमप्रभ निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणी विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा। गुरवे सर्वलोकानां विषये भवरोगिणां निधये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करं सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। साक्षात्कृतं दयानन्दं परमार्थस्वरूपिणं तत्त्वज्ञानप्रशास्तारं प्रणतोऽस्मि परं पदम्। ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवत् गीते भवद्वेषिणीम्। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयते गिरिं यत्कृपात्तमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम्। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। सेकेंड चैप्टर 54th श्लोक। अर्जुन उवाच।
अर्जुन उवाच
स्थितप्रज्ञस्य का भाषा।
स्थितप्रज्ञस्य का भाषा।
समाधिस्तस्य केशव।
समाधिस्तस्य केशव।
इतदीक्षिं प्रभाषेत। किमासीत व्रजेत किम्। सो हियर अर्जुन आस भगवान कृष्ण स्थितप्रज्ञस्य का भाषा इति। व्हाट इज द डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ Yastaprajna. Because Bhagavan himself has used, if you remember, the first shloka. First. When we chant, you can keep your mic unmuted. Otherwise, you keep your mic mute, please. The noise, background noise. So, the first shloka, 11th shloka of this chapter. Ashochyan anvashochastvam prajnyavadamscha bhashase. So, there, Bhagavan Krishna has used prajnyavadamscha bhashase. So, the prajna is not a new word for Arjuna. He has heard from the mouth of Bhagavan Krishna himself. Prajna Vadan, the words of the wisdom of a wise person, you speak. Prajna Vadan Shabhashase Iti, the 11th shloka. That is the first Upadesha shloka. That is Upadesha of Bhagavan Krishna starts from, Gita starts from here, from that shloka. Second chapter, Gita Upadesha. So the prajna is not a new word for Arjuna because he has heard from the mouth of Bhagavan Krishna himself. Therefore, he is asking, Chita prajna se ka bhasha. What it means to be a wise person is the prajna. How this jnanam can bring a transformation in one's life, in my life. This is Arjuna's my life. How this jnanam can bring about a transformation? And how does a wise person, the jnani, he behaves so that I can imitate him by imitating, by faking, I can make up, faking and making it up. That is, it is not just imitation. By seeing the qualities of the person, by seeing the behavior of the person, you start practicing those qualities. That is how you bring in the inner transformation. The qualities which you see very spontaneously in a jnani, in a sadaprajna, that becomes the sadhana for the sadhaka. So, therefore, the traits, the qualities which are spontaneous for a jnani, that has to be deliberately practiced by a mumukshu, by a sadhaka. Therefore, it becomes their sadhana. So, what is sadhyam for jnanis? What is accomplished? What is already seen? Certain traits, certain behavior, how they handle the life situation, that becomes the sadhana, the means to be deliberately followed by the mumukshu, the seeker of knowledge, the moksha, freedom. So therefore, he asks this question, Chitaprajna se ka bhasha. How do you define a Chitaprajna? What is the definition of a person whose wisdom, the jnanam, is steady, sthita? It is not shaking. There is no shake in his wisdom. His wisdom is always steady. Stita means steady. Opposite of steady is shaky. If the wisdom is shaky, he is a samsari. There is no wisdom really. If it is steady, then he is a jnani. So it is presence and absence of this wisdom. The wisdom present in whom is a sitaprajna. The wisdom is absent in whom is an ajnani. So that's the difference between jnani and ajnani. Because he has jnanam, therefore only it is the jnanam is steady. And the manifestation of that steadiness that you see in his interaction in the world, with the people in the world. So therefore Arjuna wants to know what are the behavioral the traits of the person. The prajna ka bhasha iti samadhistasya. Samadhista is another word for chitaprajna, same meaning. Chitaprajnasya, chitaprajna means chitaprajna yasya saha, the one whose prajna is steady. Samadhisthasya also is same. Samadho sthitaha. Samadhisthaha. Samadho. That is the samadhi is the one who is absorbed in this Atma, Atma Tattva, whose knowledge is the one who is abiding in Atma, who is with himself, who is at home, is a wise person, who stays with himself. Stays with himself means Atma, is with himself. He sees everything as Anatma. And not everything as Anatma, everything is Anatma only. And he has the clear perception, the clear the vision. So he stays with himself, Atma. That is, he is not disturbed by the Anatma Prapancha. He is not disturbed by the world because he is with himself. He is one with Atma. He understands himself to be Atma, the same Atma. Is not different from Paramatma, and the Paramatma alone has become the world. So therefore, there is no Anatma really speaking. There is nothing other than Atma. That vision he has. Anatma Prapancha itself is Ishvara. There is no Anatma, it is Bhagavan. That is the vision, that is the ultimate jnana. From the onlooker standpoint, for the onlookers, this world is distractive, this world is Anatma. If it is taken to be Anatma, that Anatma Prapancha will not disturb this person because he is with himself. Therefore, Samadho Sthitaha. So, Samadho Sthitaha is it with himself. With himself means he is this Sharira, this Mana Sangata, that Abhimana, not there for him. He is in his understanding that Agam Satchit Ananda Swarupa Atma, that in that understanding he abides always. When he knows that he is that, he will not be distracted by anything other than that. So therefore, he has the knowledge, he has the jnanam of Atma all the time. Therefore, always abides in that knowledge. Therefore, Atmanishta, Jnananishta, Brahmanishta, Ityartha. The word Samadhistaha means. So, Samadhistasya, He Keshava. So, what is the Lakshanam? What is the Lakshanam of Siddha Prajna? And what is the Samadhistasya? The one whose Jnanam is well established in the knowledge that Aham Satchit Swarupa, Satchit Ananda Atma is very much convinced in this knowledge. Therefore, there is no scope for any even habitual mistake. Habitual mistake, he never, even by mistake, he will not take himself to be this Sharira Mana, Sharira, this body, mind, sense complex. With this, is free. Without this also is free. He's always free. He's one with Atma. Atma is free. Therefore, he also enjoys the freedom. So, there is no even the habitual error. So, therefore, the knowledge is very clear and very firm. Stitadhihi. 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 Yasya saha. The same meaning as Siddha Prajna. The one who's the buddhi, the understanding. The means buddhi. Diyo yo naf prachodayat, the buddhi. May my buddhi be illumined with this wisdom, with this knowledge. That is what the meaning of the Gayatri Mantra. May my buddhi be illumined by this knowledge. What knowledge is jnanam of Atma. In the beginning, the Gayatri is a upasana, but later it is more than a upasana. That mantra has got, the mantra as a prayer for, it's a prayer to Bhagavan for gaining this jnana. So that japa itself becomes a sadhanam, it becomes a prayer for understanding the truth. Agam Atma, Satchit Ananda Atma. So sthita dihi, the one who is the buddhi is sthita, is very firm. Where? In this jnana. So sitadihi kim prabhasheta, how would he? Prakarshena bhasheta. Bhasheta is speak. How would he speak? How would he speak means how would he respond to different people, different situations? There are so many provoking situations. Some people they praise, some people they criticize. Therefore, tulya manapa manayoho, tulya nindasatarbhavani santushtaha yet yanakena chit. In 12th chapter, Bhagavan Krishna says, so for him, the praise, the criticism, everything he is saying is not carried over by that. Therefore, he is not provoked. So, therefore, how would he respond to different situations? Kim asita, katam asita, how does he sit, how does he eat, how does he walk? So, all this, the behavioral, the traits which Bhagavan, which Arjuna wants to know from Bhagavan Krishna. Therefore, is asking so that he can set a role model and emulate the qualities of a jnani and follow. By following the traits of a jnani, one can become a jnani. That is called imitation. Imitation with the intention of becoming that. That is why we have imitation of Christ and all the book. The book is that. So, imitation. We have this imitation. If imitation of Christ is there by Thomas Kempis, it's a very good book, which is Swami Vivekananda used to carry always. And during his wandering days, he says, he carries two books. One is Gita, other one is Imitation of Christ. So here in the Gita itself, that imitation is the imitation of a jnani. This is that part. This is the part 55th shloka up to the end of the chapter, imitation of Jnani. Then for which the Bhagavan replies, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Prajahati yada kamana.
Prajahati yada kamana.
Sarvan partha manogatana.
Sarvan partha manogatana.
Atman yevatmanat tushtaha.
Atman yevatmanat tushtaha.
Stita prajnyastadochyate.
Stita prajnyastadochyate.
Arjuna asks many questions as one question. So in that one shloka, many questions are there. But the essence of the question is, he wants to know about Sita Prajna, Prajnani. So that Bhagavan Krishna answers in the following important 18 shlokas, starting from 55th shloka up to the 72nd shloka, the end shloka. So, the natural, the character, the traits, the behavior of a jnani. And that becomes the sadhanam for a sadhaka. So sadhanani, it becomes lakshanani, becomes sadhanani. Tadapragya lakshanani, sadhakasya sadhanani, mumukshogo sadhanani. So that he says. So yada kaman, sarvan kaman, sarvan manogatan kaman, prajahati. Tada atmani eva atmana tushtaha chita prajnaha uchyate. So, this prajahati, prajahati means gives up. What does he gives up? Sarvan, kaman, all the desires, all the desires, giving up all the desires. And they are manogatan. They are manogatan, as that manogatan is that which appears, that which manifests, which comes in the mind. Manasi agata, agatavan kaman. That in the mind, the desires which arises. Sarvan prajahati, giving up everything. Prajahati means tyajati, giving up everything. giving up everything. Atmani eva atmana tushtaha. Atmana, atmani, atmana tushtaha. Atmani is Satchit Ananda Atma. In Atma, Atmana by himself. So, tushtaha means contented, happy. Being satisfied and happy in oneself, that is in Atma, by oneself, by the person. Then that person is called Satapragya. So a person becomes a Satapragya. Two things are talked about. When he gives up all the desires which arises in the mind and is contented, is happy, satisfied with himself. Two things. When this is there in a person, that person is called a Satapragya. So, therefore, Sarvan Kamar Rajahati, all the desires he gives up. There are two types of desires, binding desires, non-binding desires. Binding desires, that is the desires, there is, for the desires are there and there is an urge, a longing, an anchoring to fulfill the desires. Without accomplishing the desired object, one cannot be peaceful. One is restless. One is restless in accomplishing the desire. It causes disturbance in the person, without which he cannot live. Those are binding desires. So all the samsaris have this binding desire. Samsara is this desire. That is, Buddha also said, desire is the root cause of all evils. That desire, if it is binding, it is a root cause. If the desire is non-binding, then it is not a root cause. In fact, the desire, it becomes a privilege. Desire, Bhagavan's, somebody uses it, desire is a privilege. No other beings enjoy the privilege of desiring. Only human beings can desire to become better, can desire anything, and can desire and also can accomplish. That's a rare privilege which only human beings enjoy. That desire has to be non-binding. If it is binding, then it will reduce a person to animal. To animal level. If the desire is non-binding, whether it is fulfilled or not fulfilled, those type of desires which do not create any impact on the person, those desires are called non-binding desires. For a jnani, there is no binding desires. No desires can bind him because he is a jnani, he has achieved, he has gained. That has to be gained in life. Gaining is not in the form of gaining the physical thing. He has gained the already gained. He has gained that knowledge that Aham Brahma Asmi, that Aham Purnaha, I am complete, that I am complete, that Jnanam he discovers. It doesn't become complete by the accomplishment of objects or things in the world. Nobody can become complete or fulfilled by accumulating objects or people or this relation. Unless the person is complete by himself, is complete. No completion, no this purnatvam is possible. So, therefore, not knowing that aham purnaha, that only makes a person go after objects. Objects of desire, thinking that those objects will fulfill the person. But this person, this jnani, who has this understanding that aham purnaha, therefore nothing in the world can really fulfill, because he's already fulfilled. He discovers himself to be a complete person, a fulfilled person. Therefore, what desires he can have and what desires can bind this person. If at all, if he has desires, the desire only for loka sangraha, it is only for the welfare of the world. Out of jnanam, he does karma to do that karma, he must have desire, but the desires are non-binding desires. Therefore, giving up is not deliberately, it goes away in the wake of jnanam. So, He doesn't give up desire deliberately. He doesn't give up desire out of inability or incapability to fulfill the desire. He gives up desire out of self-satisfaction. He is complete. He is purnaha. He has outgrown those desires. Therefore, sarvan kaman manogatan prajahati. He conducts himself in the world, doing the das karma with the non-binding desires. That desire is really not for him. It is for loka sangraha. That is why you see many jnanis doing a lot of karma for the good of the people. By that, the person is not going to achieve anything. The person is already kritakrityaha, kritartaha. He has achieved what is to be achieved in the world. There's nothing he needs to gain. Bhagavan Krishna also says in one place, me parthasti, kinchana trishalokeshu, kinchana, in all the three worlds, nothing is there for me to accomplish. The jnani also says the same thing, nothing is there to accomplish. Everything is me. What is there to gain? So only that person, jnani, who has outgrown from this binding desires, and therefore only his knowledge is steady, therefore gives up, prajahati, having given up all the desires because of jnanam, and he is satisfied in atma, in himself, which is purnaha, which is complete. So there is complete acceptance of himself, complete acceptance of himself and the world. The world is not separate from me. Therefore, aham purnaha, there is complete acceptance, there is knowledge. Complete acceptance is knowledge. If one is not able to accept oneself, there is ajnana. Therefore, only he goes after the things in the world. When one is not acceptable to oneself, when one is acceptable to oneself, only when one discovers that one is complete. What he seeks in the world is really himself. When he understands that, he becomes complete. So therefore, atmani eva atmana tushtaha means he is satisfied with himself. Tushtaha is happy, satisfied, is contented. Because he finds all the desires fulfilled in the knowledge of himself. Therefore, atmani eva atmana tushtaha. So, therefore, the desire to seek purnatvam from the objects of the world are given up. Prajahati, sarvan kama, all the desires which arise in the mind. And he is contented, happy with himself. So, that person is called Stita Prajnaha, the man of steady wisdom, the man of ascertained jnanam, the knowledge. Stita Prajnaha, tada uchyate iti. Then the next shloka. So in this shloka, two things were talked about. One is giving up the binding desires, and second thing is tushtaha, happy with himself, happy with the knowledge which he discovered about himself. So two things. Then only is jnanam is stita. 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 Sitam jnanam. Stita prajna. Then the next shloka. 56. Dukkeshvanudvignamanaha. Sukeshu vigatas prgaha. So here also Bhagavan Krishna it gives the definition. Munihi uchyate. He is called a muni. Muni is jnani. He is called the muni jnani. Who is that? Stitadihi. Sthitadihi yasya. The one whose di, whose buddhi is stita, is steady, is called munihi. So munihi, stita prajnaha, all means same. There is no difference. Sthitadihi munihi uchyate iti. So who is that? Dukkeshu anudvignamanaha, sukeshu vigatasprigaha, vitaraha bayakrodaha, sthitadihi munihi uchyate. All the words are adjective. Adjective to this person, this which person? This wise person, this jnani, this munihi. All the words are adjective. Dukkeshu anudvignamanaha. Udvignamanaha anudvigna udvignamanaha anudvignamanaha. So when the mind gets disturbed, when there is unpleasant situation, when there is dukkham, pain is unpleasant. Nobody wants to have pain. It doesn't create happiness. It is not a pleasant thing. It is unpleasant. Even in that unpleasant things, unpleasant situation, painful situation, dukkeshu na udvigna manaha, the one whose mind, manaha, the mind, is not disturbed. Even in the painful situation, in adversities, painful situation, the one whose mind is not disturbed. When the mind will disturb, when there is painful situation, the pain is caused by, it is not caused by Atma. The pain is not caused by Atma, because Atma is a source of Ananda. Everybody loves oneself. Nobody can really hate himself. Everybody, the source of Ananda, Atma is a source of Ananda. That's why everybody loves oneself. Even a person who commits suicide, he doesn't commit suicide because of hatred for himself. Because of hatred for experiencing dukkha. He doesn't want to undergo pain. He doesn't want to undergo the suffering. Therefore, because he loves himself, therefore, to get rid of the dukkham, he kills himself. That is why it is said it's the wrong thing. Suicide is the wrong thing. Why? Because instead of taking care of the problem, instead of paying attention to the problem and solving it, you are killing the very source of Ananda. Because I, the Atma, is Ananda Swarupaha. That I don't want to see it as a dukkha. See it as a source of dukkham. It is not dukkham. The situations cause dukkham in me, but I want to avail that Ananda all the time. Therefore, to make myself free from the painful situation, I kill myself. That is called suicide. That is wrong thing. So therefore, at the level of anatma, dukkham will be there. But at the level of atma, there is no dukkham possible. Because of the problem at the anatma level, a person killing himself, the source of ananda, atma, that is a stupid thing. So that's why those who commit suicide, they are really stupid people. They don't understand this. This understanding is also not simple. Unless a person is born in a cultured, civilized family, exposed to Shastram, that person only can understand this also. That is why killing, that is considered to be a papam. Killing others is a papam. It is equally a papam to kill oneself. Both are papam only. Whether you kill others or kill yourself, killing is a killing. You don't have the privilege, the right to kill yourself. This body is given to you. You are the trustee of the body. You can use the body. You can use this body because you are a trustee. It has been entrusted to you and it has been left under the care of you. That's something which Bhagavan has left under the care of you. You cannot abuse it. You cannot misuse it. You cannot kill it. When you use that, what is that in the world we call? It is adharma. It is papam. As you cannot betray other person by robbing of the person's property. Similarly, this property is Bhagavan's property. Killing that is betrayal of the Bhagavan's trust. The body, for the body, you are the trustee. And this trust belongs to Bhagavan. This body is as a trust belongs to Bhagavan. Okay, you kill it. Therefore, it's a papam. So, in two ways, it is a papam. One is you are misappropriating the property of Bhagavan. Second thing, you are killing. The killing is also a papam. So therefore, not overpowered by the anatma prapancha. Anatma prapancha, the prapancha, the world to which you have the transaction. The pain or sukham is bound to come at the level of your, in terms of your experience. Above all, a jnani knows that Atma is Ananda Swarupaha, that I am Atma. So being undisturbed, whether by this painful situation or even by pleasant situation, both. That is it. The next line is Sukeshu Vigatas Prigaha. So the person who enjoys the steady mind, the mind is the cause of all the problem. Manameva Manushyanam Karanam Bandha Moksha Yoho. A jnani has a mind with himself under his management. An ajnani, the mind is all over. He has given the key for operating the mind to others, to the world he has given. Therefore, the anatma prapancha can disturb the person very well. Therefore, his mind is always disturbed. Because you allow the other person to disturb you, because you have given the key for disturbance to others. Whereas jnani, he enjoys undisturbed mind. Therefore, no situations or nothing in the world can really disturb him. So therefore, he enjoys is Surupananda. He is not born by Vishayananda. Vishaya means objects. His ananda is not dependent on the objects of the world. His ananda is dependent on himself. So therefore, he enjoys with himself, with undisturbed mind. Therefore, dukkeshu anudvignamanaha, his mind is not disturbed in painful situation because of this knowledge. Therefore, only we say knowledge protects you. Knowledge is wealth. This is really wealth. What is real wealth? This knowledge. This knowledge only protects a person. So, therefore, dukkeshu anudvignamanaha. What about sukha? Sukeshu vigatas prigaha. Even with regard to sukha also. When dukkha comes, you will not feel depressed. When sukha comes, you will not jump and hit the ceiling also. With regard to the pleasant, comfortable situation also, it's not disturbed. Both are disturbances. Sukha situation, pleasant situations are equally disturbing as painful situation. Both are disturbances only. A jnani is above that. A gold coin, whether it's a gold chain or an iron chain. Chain is a chain. It binds you because it is gold. Can you be bound by the golden chain? That is also a shackle. It has to be cut. So, therefore, jnani is free even from craving for this pleasant situation. Because he's a jnani. A samsari, what a samsari generally does, he avoids painful situation and goes after pleasant situation. And not understanding that present situation also will become a painful situation later, because there is nothing in the really in the world which is a source of pleasure all the time. That which is a source of pleasure now will become the source of pain tomorrow. And that will become the source of pleasure again. That is why it's called samsara. The jnani knows very well. Therefore, he neither runs after painful situation nor runs after the pleasant situation. He is free from craving for pleasant situation and is free from being disturbed by the painful situations also. Therefore, sukeshu vikatas prigaha, with regard to comfortable pleasant situation also is free. Vikataha is vikatas prigaha. Spriga is desire. So is because dukkam is there, therefore a person naturally runs after sukham. A jnani is free from that. He's free from craving for pleasant situation, pleasant things. If it is there, enjoys. If not there, it is okay. No problem. He continues because he is happy with himself. So he doesn't run after them. If it comes, accept. If it doesn't come, okay. Agate swagatam kuryat. Gachate na nivarayet. When it comes, welcome it. When it goes, send it off. That's simple. The jnani has this attitude. So, sukeshu vigatas pragaha. And is vita raga bayak krodaha. Vita means free. Is free from raga. Raga means we can bring raga, dvesha also. Raga is dependency. Raga is dependency. That longing, the liking is dependent on the world for its happiness. The one who is dependent on the world for happiness is called ragi. The one who is free from dependency is called vita ragi. Dependence, free from dependency, free from being dependent on the world is a vita ragi. So this jnani is a vita ragi. Similarly, is a vita bhaya, is free from fear. The fear will be there when there is a second thing. Vaitadhi bhayam bhavati. When there is a second thing, then fear comes because there is a fear of security, insecurity, because the second thing is there. Only when there is a second thing, a person experiences insecurity, fear. The fear is because of insecurity. He feels insecure because there is a second thing. When there is another person who is overqualified, who is more prosperous, who has more authority, naturally you will feel insecure because that person is a competitor or overpowers you. So bhayam. But jnani is free from that bhayam. Who can conquer him? Because he has conquered himself. Therefore, he has conquered himself means he has understood himself. He is purnaha. Therefore, when he is complete, who can influence his purnatvam? Nobody can do. Therefore, there is no fear for him. Because he has this advaita atma jnanam. So, there is no fear. There is no element of fear in jnani. And krodaha, nothing has really caused anger in the person. Because he is free from raga and dvesha. So, what can cause krodha? No desire is there. Only desire can cause krodha. Krodha, the anger is nothing but the obstructed desire. When the desires are obstructed, anger comes. Jnani doesn't have any binding desire. Free from binding desires. When he enjoys, for him, the whole world is life itself is an enjoyment. It is a leela. Where is krodha for him? He doesn't have this bandha icha, therefore is free from krodha. Therefore, vita raga bhaya krodha. It is one word, vita raga bhaya krodha. So, this vitaha raga bhaya krodha yasmat saha. From whom this raga bhaya krodha has gone, has left that person. That person is stitadhihi. That person is who is called by the name Stitadehi Sitaprajnaha. He is a man of study, wisdom, study, knowledge. Dighi means buddhi, knowledge here. The one who is knowledge is study. That person is called Munihi. So Munihi is equal to Stitadihi. So that person is called a Muni, a Jnani, who enjoys this study, knowledge, wisdom. So therefore, here three things are talked about. One is Dukkeshu Anudvigdamanaha, free from disturbances caused by unpleasant situation. Then Sukeshu Vigatas Prakaha, free from longing for pleasant situation. And Vitaraga Bayat Krodaha is free from Raga, Baya, and Krodha. So three things are talked about. These three things in whom that person is called. The person enjoys Chitadihi, the knowledge which is steady, and that person is called Munihi, Jnani, Ityartha. That is the meaning. Then the next shloka we will read. Yes, sarvatra nabisnegaha.
Yes, sarvatra nabisnegaha.
Tat prapya shubha shubham. Nabhinandati nadveshti. Yes. So Tasya Pragna Pratishtita. His knowledge is Pratishtita. Prakashena Tishtita Samyak Pratishtita is well established. Whose knowledge? That is described here. That is with the Pragnasya Pragna Pratishtita. So Yaha Sarvatra Anabhisnegaha Tattat Prapya Shubhashubham Na Abhinandati Na Tveshti. So, sarvatra anabhisnegaha. Sarvatra is everywhere. Everywhere are with every person, with regard to every person. Everywhere means with regard to everything, everybody. Anabhisnegaha. Sneha. Sneha from the dhatu snik. That which is sticky is called snik. Sneha. That is why sneha, friendship. Because friendship is sticky. That's why it's called sneha. Sneha is friendship. So, anabhisnegaha, abhisnegaha, na abhisnegaha, anabhisnegaha, sarvatra. That is free from sneha, that attachment. Is free from attachment with reference to everything, with reference to everybody, with reference to all the situations. So, free from the person, situations, or objects. Yaha sarvatra anabhisnegaha, the one who is free from attachment to person or situations or objects. That way sarvatra, everywhere. Abhisnegaha means attachment. Sneha means love. Sneha means this love. Abhisnegaha means too much love, excessive. Too much of this sneha. Opposite of that is anabhisnegaha. So yaha anabhisnegaha, the one who is free from this excessive love or attachment. So the sneha can be a source of strength. If sneha is because of the attachment, then it is weakness. If sneha is, it comes from one's strength, then it is beneficial. So it is the sneha, whether it is a sign of weakness or whether it is the sign of strength, it depends. Sneha as such is whether as such it is neither weak nor strong. It depends from where the sneha comes from, the source of sneha. that determines what the sneha is. So if the sneha, if the love binds a person, then it is weakness. If the sneha makes a person grow, then it is beneficial, it is good. See, because in the name of sneha, there should not be bondage, there should not be attachment. Because where sneha is there, where love is there, the misunderstood love can bind a person, can put another person to bondage. Or you yourself can become bound to another person. That sneha is not really a sneha. It doesn't come from strength. It is a source of, it is, in fact, it is weakness. Because the source is dependency. That is, it has got dependency. The sneha which has dependency on others, that sneha is weak. The sneha which is independent, that is strong. So here, this sneha, what we talk about, abhisneha, the sneha, the love which can make a person dependent. This jnani is independent. Nothing can bind. Therefore, we translate the word sneha as attachment. Therefore, we translate the word sneha as that which can bind you, attachment. So, when you have viveka, when viveka shakti is operative, then you can keep this sneha. You can analyze this sneha and you can keep the sneha in check. You can analyze whether it comes from being dependent or being independent. If the sneha, the love comes from the sources other than me, and I depend on them, then it is harmful. Then it is attachment. Then it is harmful, and then you can conclude that there is no viveka in that. That is because of aviveka only the sneha can take a person to moha and therefore dukkham. That is why the sneha, normally a samsari, a person takes a person to dukkham. The one who loves experiences sorrow in the world. Why? Because the sneha is not an expression of fullness. It is an expression of bondage. When sneha is an expression of bondage, it binds you. When sneha is an expression of purnatvam, then it grows. You become free. Already you are free. You make other person also free. If the sneha can bind you and lead to moha and sorrow, that sneha is because of aviveka. If sneha really comes out of the fulfillment, purnatvam, that is because of the understanding. That is because of the understanding. And that has to be appreciated, and that you see in a jnani. With regard to any situation, with any people in the world, sarvatra anabhisnehaha is not attached to anything because he is himself the source of the fullness, the happiness. Therefore, there is no need for him to depend on the things or people of the world. There is no dependency for him. There is no emotional dependency on anyone. So therefore, sarvatra anabhisnehaha is free from being attached to anything or anybody in the world. And therefore, tattat prapya shubhashubham. Tattat prapya. Tattat referring to prapya, gaining. Gaining pleasant or unpleasant situation. Shubha, ashubha. Shubha is pleasant or good things. Ashubha is unpleasant or inauspicious things. So with regard to that, shubha, ashubha, prapya. Shubham prapya, ashubham prapya. With regard to both, he is free. With regard to both, shubham prapya na abhinandati, ashubham prapya na dveshti. So with regard to pleasant thing, gaining of pleasant things, na abhinandati, it doesn't enjoy. He doesn't enjoy means he doesn't jump and hit the ceiling. He is of the same person. because nothing can really add to his happiness. So therefore, na abhinandati. Similarly, ashubham prapya na dveshti. Similarly, gaining ashubha, inauspicious or unpleasant thing, it doesn't na dveshti, it doesn't hate them. It doesn't have any hatred for them. It doesn't become a dukhi. Because this shubha or ashubha, which are the source of bringing ananda and dveshti, with regard to both of them, because he has jnanam, therefore, because he has jnanam and he understands himself to be complete, to be fulfilled. He understands himself to be a complete person. Therefore, gaining of the shubha or ashubha cannot have any dent on the person in terms of giving the ananda anubhava or dukkha anubhava. Both anubhava it cannot give, because he is ever in this atmananda. Therefore, gaining of this vishaya, vishayananda, or vishaya dukkha, this vishaya which can give him ananda or dukkha, which can give generally a person ananda or dukkha, for this jnani, with regard to jnani, this do not have any say over it, over him, over the person, jnani. Why? Because he is sarvatra anabhisneha, is completely unattached to everything in the world. Therefore, gaining of pleasant thing cannot make him happy. Gaining of unpleasant things also equally cannot make him a sad person, a dukkhi. So he is free from sukha and dukkha. His freedom is ever free. His freedom is untouched. His freedom is untouched by the gaining of, his freedom is his ananda. His ananda is ever untouched by the gaining of sukha anubhava, the pleasant situation, or dukkha anubhava, unpleasant situation. Then therefore only enjoys the chitta jnanam, the prajna. Therefore, tasya prajna pratishtita. His knowledge is steady, well established. Who is free from this sneha, abhisnegaha? Here Bhagavan Krishna uses the word abhisnegaha, excessive, over the love or attachment. Therefore, tattat prapya, tattat referring to tattat prapya. On gaining the tat shubham prapya, tat ashubham prapya, this tata prajnaha na abhinandati na dveshti. Dveshti is from the dvishdhatu. Dveshti, latlakara pratam purusha, it is ekvachanam. Dveshti, dvishdhatu, dveshti. From this only the word dvesha comes, raga dvesha, from this same dhatu, dvish. So, therefore, sadaprajnaha sarvatra sneha ragitaha bhavati. Shubham prapya na abhinandati, ashubham prapya api na dveshti. Therefore, he is untouched. He is untouched by sukha dukkha, because he is sukha dukkha titaha. He is above the sukha dukkha of this world. Sukha dukkha is only for a samsari, not for a jnani. If sukha dukkha have a dent, you can have a say over the person, then that person is not a jnani. Everybody in the world is after sukham. Sukha praptaye pravrtihi. And everybody interested in getting rid of dukkham. Dukkha nivrtaye nivrtihi. So, the way of the world is either running after sukham or getting rid of dukkham. Only two things. One is getting, other one is getting rid of. Getting sukham, getting rid of dukkham. For jnani, there is no getting or there is no getting rid of. Because by gaining sukha vastu, by gaining shubham, pleasant situation, is not overjoyed. By getting ashubham, unpleasant situation also, it doesn't become dukkhi, sorrowful. So therefore, his jnanam is steady. That can be inferred. So this is shloka is very appropriate for Arjuna, because in the battlefield, having seen his kith and kin right in front, whom he is going to kill, because he has confidence in himself that they all will become prey to his arrows. That only made Arjuna sorrowful. So therefore, Jnani is one who is free from the influence of the Sukha or Dukkha Anubhava. Therefore, Arjuna is specifically given, because Arjuna is highly demotivated. So therefore, by defining the Sita Prajna, by giving the Lakshana of Sita Prajna, Arjuna can imitate the qualities. So with regard to anything, even with regard to the war also, without being attached to the people, without being attached to kith and kin, as a kshatriya, he should do his dharma, yudha dharma. This is applicable to all the sadhakas, in whichever position in life, in whichever stage one person is. The person is supposed to do what he is supposed to do, because being endowed with a particular duty or the karma, the person is supposed to do without any hatred for people, or without even attachment for people or situation. Then only by imitating it, then only the jnanam also becomes. So this is a sadhanam. This is a sadhanam for a sadhaka. This has to be practiced. This has to be practiced by a mumukshu. So his jnanam is steady. Whose jnanam? The knowledge of the person, the wise person, is steady, and his behavior in the prapancha, in the world, how does he behave? He remains undisturbed. That being undisturbed is what that trait which a sadhaka has to inculcate. So therefore, this becomes a sadhanam for a sadhanam for a sadhaka. This is a sataprajna lakshanam, the characteristics of a sataprajna. That becomes a sadhanam that one has to bring it in or emulate in one's life. Therefore, lakshanam, sataprajna lakshanam, sadhakasya sadhanam iti. Then Bhagavan Krishna in the next shloka, he says, how this prajna can be made steady? He gives, yes, sadhana. Even though here he talks about the lakshanam of Sita Prajna, here he gives the sadhanam also, directly. Everything is a lakshanam only, but directly he gives a sadhanam. It can be taken as a lakshanam or it can be taken as a sadhanam, both. You'll read that shloka 58. Yada samharate chayam.
Yada samharate chayam.
Kurmungani vasarvashaha.
Kurmungani sarvashaha.
Indriyani indriyarthebhyaha.
Indriyani
prajna pratishthita. We will see the meaning of this shloka in the next class. Yam brahma varunendra rudra marutah stunvanti divyaistavaihi Vedai Sangha Padakramopanishadaihi Gayanti Yam Samagaha Dhyanavastita Tadgatena Manasam Pashyanti Yam Yoginaha Yasyantam Navidusura Suraganaha Devayatasmai Namaha Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.
धन्यवाद गुरु जी,
धन्यवाद
धन्यवाद कृष्ण जी।